Okay, good afternoon. Let's stand and let's open up in a word of prayer. Father, we just come and we just thank you. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for loving us. We thank you for your word. And Lord, we come here to worship and honor you this afternoon and give you all the praise and all the glory. And everybody said, amen. Amen.
Let's go around and greet and love on one another this afternoon. And
you can do all things, heal every sickness, free every captive. You can do all things, restore what is broken, blind eyes are open. The mountains melt like wax before you, God. So let all the earth rejoice in who you are. Do it again, do it again. Everything we've seen and more. Do it again, do it again. Lord, we believe for more to do it again. You can do all things. You heal every sickness, free every captive. And you can do all things. Restore what is broken, blind eyes are open. The mountains melt like wax before you, God. So let all the earth rejoice in who you are. And do it again, do it again. Lord, we believe for more. Do it again, do it again. Lord, we believe for more. Do it again, do it again. Everything we've seen and more. Do it again, do it again. Lord, we believe for more. So do it again. You can do all things. You heal every sickness, free every captive. And you can do all things. Restore what is broken, blind eyes are open. The mountains melt like wax before you, God. So let all the earth rejoice in who you are. And do it again, do it again. Everything we've seen and more. Do it again, do it again. Lord, we believe for more. You do it again, everything we've seen and more. Do it again, Lord, we believe for more. So do it again. On your faithfulness, oh God, let me not forget to sing in the valley, to look toward your goodness. My heart set on who you are. You're the light that consumes the dark, the joy and the strength to lift up my hands and see. I enter the gates, come reckless with praise. I'll bring a heart that wants you first, all for your glory. My feet on the battleground, oh, my weapon will be my sound. I will not be silent, my song is my triumph. I enter the gates with nothing but thanks. I want to magnify your worth, I want to bring you more than words. I enter the gates, come reckless with praise. I'll bring a heart that wants you first, all for your glory. Sing, my soul will sing, my soul will make this place an altar, oh, make this place an altar. Sing, my soul will sing, my soul will make this place an altar, make this place an altar. Oh, sing, my soul will sing, my soul will make this place an altar, make this place an altar. Oh, sing, my soul will sing, my soul will make this place an altar, make this place an altar. I enter the gates with nothing but thanks. I want to magnify your worth, I want to bring you more than words. I enter the gates, come reckless with praise. I'll bring a heart that wants you first, all for your glory. I enter the gates with nothing but thanks. I want to magnify your worth, I want to bring you more than words. I enter the gates, come reckless with praise. I'll bring a heart that wants you first, all for your glory. Your glory, it's all for your glory. Your glory, it's all for your glory. Your glory. Your glory. Oh, yes, Lord, we enter your gates with thanksgiving. Oh, we worship you, Lord. Light.
Let's start that one again.
Oh, light of the world, light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see the beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. And humbly you came to the earth that you created, all for love's sake you became poor. Oh, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, you're altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Oh, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'll never know, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Oh, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon thy cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon thy cross. Oh, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am, Lord, to say that you're my God. You are altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Lift your voice and tell him, here I am to worship, here I am, Lord, to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You are altogether lovely, altogether so worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am, Lord, to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You are altogether so lovely, altogether so worthy, altogether you're wonderful to me. Yes, you are, Lord. Lift your voice and tell him, oh, we worship you, Lord. You are worthy, so worthy. Lord, here we are to worship. Here we are, give you our praise. Lord, we extol the praise upon you. Oh, you're so lovely. You're so good, Lord. Oh, you're so good to me. Yes, you are, Lord. Here we are to worship. Here we are, Lord, in your presence. Oh, yes, we are, Lord. You're altogether lovely, altogether beautiful to me. Yes, you are, Lord. Oh, we worship you. Oh, yes, Lord. We'll worship you.
Thank you, Lord. Let's pray in the Spirit. Lord, we just come to you. We just give you praise. We just give you glory. We just give you honor, God, for you are so good and you are worthy, Lord, of all of our praises. As we come to the Lord in prayer, if you need prayer today, why don't you raise your hand so I can see who you are? All right, couple. All right, well, I'm just going to ask you if you're just going to come on down, and Pastor Lewis and Sandy are going to pray with me, and we're going to agree with you, because we know that God is a big God, right? And we know that he hears and he answers all of our prayers, right? And he speaks to us and he leads us. And sometimes people say, well, how do I know if I'm praying amiss? Well, if you're praying the word of God, you're not praying amiss. So is it amiss to ask God for healing in your body? No. Is it amiss for God, ask God to help you with your finances? No. Is it amiss for God to help you in your family and to heal and reconcile family situations? No. So praying amiss simply means when we're trying to control other people, because the bottom line is we can't control each other. The other bottom line is I don't want to control you, and I know you can't control me, right? And we don't try to control each other, but what we do is we pray and we go to God and we intercede on behalf of others, and we ask the Lord to send laborers into their path and to speak to them about God. And that's out of power, and that's out of love. So get the whole idea of you're praying amiss out of your head. Amen? That's religion. Because most people, they don't pray amiss. We're coming before the throne of God. We're making our petitions known. That's what the scripture says for us to do. So as you come today, come, make your petitions known. Come in faith. We're going to agree with you in faith. And we're going to expect and receive the answer. Amen? Look at your neighbor and tell them God's got the answer. All right.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah! Christ is risen. We bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. We bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. We bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. We bow down before Him, for he is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Amen. You may be seated. God is so good and he's moving. Praise the Lord. And I just want to challenge you while we're on our very last week of our 21-day fast. And I hope that's going well for you. I hope you're enjoying the prayer and fasting guides, and it gives us prayers to pray for, especially for our city, and I hope you're participating in that. And anyway, so this is a year of power, right? Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, this is my year of power, right? And so we have the ability to overcome those things that ensnared us in 2018, and we can hit 2019 running, knowing that we've got the power of the Holy Spirit on the inside of us. We got the Word of God, and we can face anything, any challenge, and we know how to pick up our sword. We know how to speak the Word, and we know how to take authority, right? And so God is taking us in Word of Life into another level. We're going up to another level. And as we go up to that other level, we can see some things happening. If you need to be delivered of something, I'm telling you right now, get delivered. It's just that easy, just like that. Decide you're going to make a change in your life. Decide you're going to let all that old junk go. You know, the devil likes to keep us bound. He likes to keep us bound up and strapped up and tormented and all of that. And I want to tell you something about people who aren't delivered. They are tormented each and every day of their life, especially church people. And they come in and they walk in a lot of shame, and they walk in a lot of grief, because they feel like they can't get over whatever it is that they're struggling with. But I'm going to tell you, you don't have to come in here like that. You can come here and decide that you'd let Jesus, did he not save us? Did he not die for us? Did he not take our sins on that cross for us? Did he not do all of that so that we could be free from whatever entangles us? Absolutely. And so you come into this church and you allow the power of the Holy Spirit to hit you, and you walk out that door different in the name of Jesus. Amen. And that's what the Word of God will do for you. You make a decision that 2019 is my year, and this is the year that I'm going to walk in power, and that I'm delivered from all the past, all the hurts, all the pain that used to entangle me, and I'm going to go on to freedom and going up to the next level, because I want to go from glory to glory to glory. Amen? Amen. And so if you needed to hear that today, that was strictly the Holy Spirit, not a part of what I was going to say today. So say, I receive it, and you go on to glory. Amen. Praise God. I'm excited about 2019 because I think it's a different, we have a different way of looking at things. We have a different way of viewing this year, and we're going to go on to more power. And I believe at the end of this year, we're going to turn around and we're going to see how God has truly moved, not only in our own individual lives, but in Word of Life. And I believe that. Do you believe that too? Well, a couple of announcements. So continue to fast and pray. By setting aside those first portion of the year and going to the Lord in prayer, and we're fasting and praying, we're all getting on the same page. Amen. And we're getting prepared. We're strengthening ourselves up for the coming year. And God has some great things for us in this year. Praise the Lord. Are y'all happy today? Or I'm the only one happy? I'm happy. God is good, right? Yeah. Lots to be joyful and thankful for. Praise the Lord. Well, just a couple of announcements. So this Wednesday, Julie will be teaching the Bible study, and she'll be there at 7 o'clock. Last Wednesday, because of all the flash flooding and all that kind of stuff, we canceled the service, but we will be there this Wednesday. I will be in Texas this week for the Kenneth Copeland Ministers Conference, and so y'all pray for me so I fly out tomorrow. I will be back next Sunday. So next Sunday when you come, you just come with your seatbelt on ready, because I'm going to be full. Amen. Amen. And so, anyway, just be praying for me. And there's some things that are happening with Pastor Ross that are pretty amazing that I can't share yet. But continue to pray for him, especially this Friday. I can't say where he is located, somewhere in the Middle East, but he will be speaking at that country's embassy on Friday, which is a pretty big deal. He's going to be preaching there. So keep him up in your prayers, and we pray for anointing and favor as he gives the word of God, and that God will give him the right word. Amen? Amen. All right, so we have a couple of birthdays today. One birthday is out of town. One birthday is here. So come on down, Mike. We have any more birthdays, Julie? Not that you know of? All right. Today is actually your birthday, right? All right. You going to tell me how old you are? 29. I've known, he's 29 years old. Let's see, how old were you when I first met you? You're a little guy, 5 years old. Aw, my baby's growing up. Well, we appreciate Mike. Mike has served our country, and he has been faithful to come and to hear the Word of God and to be a part of Word of Life, and we just watched him grow up, and we're excited. I'm excited what God's doing in your life. So, Julie, you're going to stand, and we're going to sing Happy Birthday to Mike. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday, dear Mike, happy birthday to you, and many more. All right, let's reach our hands out towards Mike, and we're going to pray for him, okay? So, Father, I just come in the name of Jesus. We plead the blood of Jesus over Mike. Lord, we know that you have a plan and a path for his life. We take authority over the enemy that would try to steal, kill, and destroy that plan. Father, I pray that 2019 is his year, that he grows closer and closer to you like he never has before. Father, I pray that you open doors for him, that you lead him and that you guide him. God, I just thank you for his life. I thank you that he's a blessing, that he's a good father, and that he's a good son, Lord, and he cares about his family, Father. I just ask, Lord God, that of all the desires of his heart, Father, the ones that were put there by you, God, bring to completion. And I ask this in Jesus' name, and that when he looks back at 2019, that he says, surely the Lord was with me. And we ask these in your name, amen. Amen. All right, Mike, we love you. Proud of you. Praise God. All right, are y'all ready to give? Yay! It's time to give. So, Carol, it's time to make out your tithes and offering. If you want to give by texting, you see the info right there. Praise the Lord. There you go. You don't text.
God is so good, isn't he? Malachi, everybody knows this scripture, but I love it anyway. It's in Malachi 3:10. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test or prove me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. Can you say amen? Woo, that's a good scripture, isn't it? I just love that scripture. Because, you know, no matter how much we give, we cannot outgive God. Can you say amen? You know, he has been so good to us. You know, he gives us everything that we need and more. He gives us abundance of grace. He gives us abundance of health. He gives us abundance of food. I don't want to say that too loud. And yesterday we went to, I don't know if anybody's ever been there, but Logan's candy factory, where they make candy, and the older man, was making the candy canes and hard candy, and oh, it was just seeing all that. It was great. And so, needless to say, I can't wait, Harley, for this week to be over, because we bought bags of candy. So, any candy you've ever seen there, they have it there at Logan's. And they've been there since 1935. That was before I was born. But anyway, so that was my plug for them. But if you have your tithe, please don't forget to put it in the bucket. Let's see, who's going to pray today? How about you, Sandy? Pastor Sandy, stand and say God's blessing.
All right. Is this in the right place? I didn't think so. I'll let Ricky figure that out. All right. Well, Pastor Sandy is teaching children's church today, so kids, you're dismissed, and you can go with Pastor Sandy. I know she's got a good word for you. I know it's throwing me off. There we go. Yay. All right. Thank you, Pastor Sandy. So, anyway, just feel free to go back. How many are you glad came to church this afternoon? Right? How many of you brought your Bibles? Good. So, let's go to the Lord and let's pray. Father, we just come to you. We just thank you for your word. We thank you, God, that your word speaks to us and speaks in us, Father. We thank you, God, that it develops our faith as we hear it, Lord. I pray for each person here today that our faith would be developed as we hear this word. We receive it and we take it and we act on it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And so the title of my sermon today is Speak Life. And as the new year rolls around and during our time of fasting and praying, it's kind of time to take inventory of our lives and reevaluate some things. And maybe you've got off track with your words or your thoughts or grown slack in devotional time. And so I just want to remind you of Proverbs 18:21 that says, your words are so powerful, they will kill or give life. And we want to be life givers. Amen. Raise your hand if you want to be a life giver, right? So it's by what we say. You know, the 21-day corporate prayer and fasting is a time that we recalibrate our spiritual lives so that we can receive from God the direction for the year 2019. And so, as you're fasting and as you're praying, don't be surprised if the Holy Spirit speaks to you and you need to make some adjustments. I just want to say, did you know that everyone has to make adjustments in their spiritual life? We all have to adjust. We all have to listen to God. It's called being led by the Spirit. We make ourselves available to the Holy Spirit through fasting and prayer, and He begins to talk to us, and He begins to instruct us. And so sometimes we have to make those adjustments, and most of the time, the adjustments are in our words. And you know, it's always good to evaluate what you're speaking, because sometimes we grow lax. And this is what I want to encourage you about today. Every word you speak is powerful. And sometimes we get lax or lazy about our words and we'll just speak any old thing. But every word you speak is powerful and we want to speak what God is speaking, right? Especially over our lives, our health, our families, our church, over our finances. We have to be diligent about speaking the word of God. And it's important to know what you're speaking over yourself. What do you say about you? Are you speaking life or are you speaking fear, doubt, and unbelief? Proverbs. If you turned in your Bible to Proverbs chapter 10, verse 11, and I think I'll just turn over there right now. And it says, the mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life, and his words of wisdom are a source of blessing. So I want my words to be a source of blessing, to give life. Words are like seeds. When you are who you are today because of what you've been saying about yourself yesterday. When you speak something out, you're giving life to what you're saying. If you continually to say it, eventually that can become a reality. And whether you realize it or not, you're prophesying your future. Now, this is awesome when you're saying things like, I'm blessed, I'm out of debt, you know, no weapon against me shall prosper. Then you're prophesying victory and declaring new levels. But a lot of people prophesy the opposite, like stuff like, nothing good ever happens to me. I'll probably lose my job. Every winter I get sick. People who speak negative words don't realize that they're prophesying defeat over their lives. And so when you speak out over yourself, are you looking at the glass half empty or are you looking at the glass half full? We need to start being half full lookers, right? When we look at the glass, it should be half full. We should be seeing the blessings of God over our life. And when you begin to change your perspective and change how you look, and then you have the confidence of God on the inside of you, then things begin to change. Have you ever noticed that, like, when you dress real sloppy and you put on sweats and you got your house shoes on and you just find a shirt and you pull it over yourself and you're schleffling around the house, you know, you look in the mirror and you go, whoa. But you're not going anywhere. You're not. Hopefully you don't go out in public like that. I have seen a few people in public like that, but that's a totally different sermon, right? And so, you know, you're not feeling very good about yourself. But when you go on and you put your nice shoes on and your nice clothes on and you dress up a little bit and you comb your hair back and something begins to happen to your self-confidence when you look in the mirror and you think, well, I look pretty good, you know? You feel pretty good about yourself. You're ready to face the world. Well, it's the same way with our words. When we get lax and lazy with our words and just say any old thing, oh, nothing good ever happens to me, I'm so depressed, I just wish that this day was over, I wish this week was over, I wish this month was over, I wish this year is over. Why are you wishing your life away? It goes by faster than you think, amen? And so you don't want to do that. You want to feel good about your saying. And the great thing about our words is that you can change what you're saying at any time. At any time. You can take authority over those negative words that you just spoke, and you can cause them and tell them to come to nothing. And you can say, God, I repent, and I'm going to start speaking your words. You know, I want to be a life speaker. I want to speak words of life. I want to speak words of life not only about myself, but about my church and about all of you and about whoever I come into contact with. Amen. You know, there are some people that, when you are around them and you walk in the room, they suck the life right out of you. You know what I'm talking about? Because you could be happy, you could be, you know, joyful. Even though you're going through stuff, you know that you have the peace that passes all understanding, and you talk to somebody and they're just doom, gloom, negative, nothing's going to work out. Why is this happening to me? And then what happens? Pretty soon you feel kind of low yourself, right? But I want to tell you, we don't have to feel that way. You know, it doesn't mean that we don't go through stuff. We all go through stuff because we live in this life. And Jesus said, you're going to have trouble. But the great thing is, Jesus has overcome any trouble that we could ever face. Praise the Lord. And so we're going to go through stuff. And as we go through stuff, that's a given. But listen, you're going to go through stuff the rest of your life. You're going to go through stuff. Your kids are going to go through stuff. Your family's going to go through stuff. Why? Stuff is going to happen to you. But the great thing is, no matter what is happening to me, is that the enemy cannot steal the joy that I got on the inside of me unless I let him. You hearing what I'm saying? I can be joyful going through trials and tribulations and troubles. I can be joyful knowing that God's got a plan. I can be joyful knowing that I am drawing as close to Him as I possibly can, and He's going to get me through whatever it is I'm facing. I can be joyful. And I tell you, that's part of the spiritual battle right there, is making a quality decision that you're going to believe God's word, this word right here, this right here. This is the word of God, that we're going to stand on this word, that we're going to take this word, that we're going to put this word in our heart, that nothing, if it doesn't line up with this, then it's not worth anything. This is our lifeline. This is our direct communication to God. This is what gets our prayers answered. This is what gets us to the place where we can overcome any difficult situation in our lives, is the word. And we have to make our minds up that we're going to listen to the word, that we're going to speak the word, and the word has final say in our lives. And if it has final say in our lives, then we don't need to be speaking contrary to what this word says. Amen? So if it says I'm healed, what am I? I'm healed. If it says I'm delivered, then I'm delivered. If it says I'm whole, then I'm whole. Nothing missing, nothing broken. It says absolutely all of that. So don't get mad at me because I have a great life. Amen? Don't get mad. I have struggles. I have hardships. I have things I got to overcome just like you. But I choose to walk in love and joy, knowing that my Father gives me that peace. That, do you know that God is working on your situation right now as we're in this church worshiping Him? And you could walk out that very door and the answer come to you, whatever it is that you need. That's the way that God works. Praise the Lord. So we remain joyful. We remain steady. We remain. And so Proverbs chapter 10 verse 11 says, the mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life, and his words are wisdom and a source of blessing. So we want our words to be a source of blessing, to give life. Did you know that words are like seeds? And what you are today, you've been speaking about yourself. And when you speak about something, you're giving life to what you're saying. And it soon it becomes a reality. So Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21 in the Amplified, it says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it, indulge it, will eat its fruit and bear the consequences of their words. So that's pretty sobering. We'll eat the fruit of our words. So when you, and that can be a good thing or that can be a bad thing. So when you talk, you're planting seeds, and at some point you're going to eat the fruit of it. So the challenge is making sure you're planting the right kind of seeds, right? I'm healthy. I'm well. My body lines up with the word of God. Well, Pastor Brenna, you don't know how I felt this morning when I got up. No, I don't know how you felt, but you don't know how I felt this morning when I got up either. And you know, when I got out of bed, sometimes my bones creak, and sometimes they need a little praying to get moving, right? You know, sometimes that happens. But you know what? We have the ability through the power of our tongue to speak to our bodies and say, body, line up with the word of God. Bones, line up with the word of God. And as we speak to our body, something happens on the inside. Our body receives it. Amen? And you talk to your body. You talk to your mind. And the challenge is making sure you're planting the right kind of seeds. You cannot talk negative and expect a positive life. I'm going to say that again. You can't just be talking whatever and expect God to move in your life when you're talking against His word. Amen. A lot of people don't realize that. They think, well, God, why aren't you answering my prayers? Well, God is faithful and just to answer our prayers, but what are you speaking? If you're speaking what is coming out of your mouth is contrary to what God said, then you're working against yourself and you tie God's hands. I want to tell you, God is faithful Do you understand that? Faithful to make sure his word comes to pass. Oh my goodness. Faithful. That means his word, when it's spoken out, it will produce something. So when I speak the word of God, it produces something, and it's going to come back to me, because it doesn't come back empty. So when I speak healing over my body, God is faithful over that word to bring it to pass if I will let it. Praise the Lord. But I can't be speaking healing to my body in one breath and then speaking, oh my gosh, I hurt so bad in the next breath. What am I doing? I'm canceling it out. I'm contradicting the word of God. And so you have to make up your mind, which is it? God has healed your body, or you feel so bad? God has healed your body, or you're not going to make it to the end of 2019? God has healed your body, or you feel really old? Listen, I'm going to live to 120. I declare it, and I decree it right now. And so if I'm going to live to 120, my body's got to be in good shape. My mind's got to be in good shape, right? And I got to start decreeing and declaring over my body and over my mind now to produce the word of God in my life. Does that make sense to you? It does to me. And so death and life are in the power of the tongue. And so we need to watch what we say. If you talk lack and not enough and can't afford it and you're never going to get ahead, you're going to have a poor life. That's the bottom line of it. We have to learn to speak the promises of God over our lives, our families, our finances, and our health. And your life will move, listen to this, in the direction of your words. Have you ever noticed that? When you speak life, you have life in your own lives. So we want our words to be a fountain of life and wisdom and a source of blessing, especially over ourselves, our families, and our church. So let's look at James. James chapter 3, verse 5-11. You know, James is tough. If you've ever read the book of James, he is brutal. He will make you straighten up. Whatever's in your life, you read that. You cannot read James without getting convicted. But that's what it's there for. Amen. And so the word, it keeps me on the path. James chapter 3, verse 5, it says, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it can speak big things. See how a very small fire can set many trees on fire. The tongue is a fire. It's full of wrong. It poisons the body. The tongue sets our whole lives on fire with a fire that comes from hell. Men can make all kinds of animals, birds, fish, and snakes, and do what they want them to do. But no man can make his tongue say what he wants it to say. It's sinful and does not rest. It's full of poison and kills. And with our tongue, we give thanks to our Father in heaven. And with our tongue, we speak bad words that come against people who are made like God. Giving thanks and speaking bad words come from the same mouth. My Christian brothers and sisters, that is not right. Does a well of water give good water and bad water from the same place? Can a fig tree give olives, or can a grapevine give figs? A well does not give both good and water and good water and bad water. So, what kind of words are you speaking? Because we're responsible for everything that comes out of our mouths, good and bad. Did you know that Jesus said in Luke chapter 6, verse 45, that good comes from a good man because of the riches he has in his heart? Sin comes from a sinful man because of the sin he has in his heart. The mouth speaks what the heart is full of. So when we speak, when we talk, that's what's in our hearts. So if we speak fear, fear is in our hearts. If we speak unbelief, unbelief is in our hearts. And so the condition of our hearts is the key to what we're speaking. So if you're speaking the wrong thing, then your heart needs tending to. Proverbs 4:23, it says to above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. And Psalm 141, 3 and 4, it says, O Lord, put a watch over my mouth. Keep a watch over the door of my lips. Do not let my heart turn to anything sinful to do wrong with men who sin. So, setting a guard over our hearts is also setting a guard over our mouth. Setting a guard over your heart is protecting it. What are you listening to? What are you watching? These things will affect what you're speaking. If you take a quick inventory of your words and your language and begin to realize that you've been watching or listening to the wrong material, just simply switch and listen to the right stuff. Romans 10:17 says, so then faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. And that's how we receive faith. That's why when you come to church and you hear the word of God and you walk out the door, you feel empowered, you feel built up, you feel encouraged, right? Because you just heard the word of God. Your faith increases. Well, the same thing comes. Fear comes by hearing and hearing the word of fear. Unbelief comes by hearing and hearing the word of unbelief. Doubt comes by hearing and hearing the word of doubt. None of these, by the way, are your friends. That's why you don't feel very good when you're around somebody that's negative. That's why you don't feel good when you turn on the news and it's all bad. That's why you don't feel good when you hear people talk and they're not encouraging, they're not lifting up, and they're doom and gloom. And the next thing you know, you feel kind of gloomy yourself. And you wonder, what's wrong with me today? Why am I so depressed? Well, you don't have to be depressed. Did you know depression is a spirit? And you can take authority over depression anytime you want. God's word is life. Amen? It's life. It gives us life. It is our life. It's everything we need to live this life and to overcome. So it's our life. And we feed our spirits and our hearts with the word of God. When we speak the word of God, our faith grows. And as our faith develops, we can begin to see the difference of speaking words of faith and speaking words of fear. You know, many years ago, my kids started driving at, you know, 16, 17 years old. And when your first one gets their car, you know, the enemy tries to put some fear on you, right? Because all I could think of when my daughter got her driver's license was how fast everybody goes on the freeway. And she's not prepared for that. And, oh, my gosh, I'm not with her. And how's she going to make it? Well, the very first day she had a driver's license, she got into a fender bender. So there was... I did have reason to wonder if she was going to make it. But I let this fear come upon me. It just made me nervous every time she got into her vehicle because I didn't know what was going to happen. Was she going to have another fender bender? Is she going to get into a more serious accident or what? And you know, there's a time as a parent, you know you got to let go. You know you do. And you know that one of the biggest acts of faith that a person can demonstrate is when they trust God with their kids. Amen. You got to learn to trust God with your kids. And so I was struggling with this. I was struggling. I would stay up late. They had a midnight curfew because in my family, here's the saying, nothing good happens after midnight. And it's very true. And so, I don't care if you want to adopt that saying, you can. But nothing good happens after midnight. And so, they had to be home, you know, before midnight, usually by 11:30. And I would just wait and not go to sleep and wait till they come in. If they were a little bit late, I'd have to speak in tongues because I was nervous. I didn't know what was going to happen. And then one day, the Holy Spirit spoke to you. Aren't you glad the Holy Spirit speaks to you? Aren't you glad he speaks and he corrects you and he shows you what to do? And he said, Brenda, he said, how long are you going to be in fear? I go, what? I'm not in fear. He goes, you are. And he began to show me that I was in fear about my kids and their driving. He said, I want you to go out there when the car is in the driveway. I want you to lay hands on that car. I want you to plead the blood of Jesus over it. And then I want you to walk away knowing that they're with me. And I said, you're right, Lord. And so I did. As soon as they got home the next day, I went outside. I got some anointing oil, and me and Pastor Ross, we anointed that vehicle, and we plead the blood of Jesus over it, and then we plead the blood of Jesus over the kids where they went. But the point that I'm trying to make is that God knew my heart, and I was speaking fear out of my heart. And I had to make an adjustment. I had to change what I was saying. And you know, we all have to do that. Especially at the first of the year, it's a good time to make those adjustments in your life. Begin to change what you're saying. Don't be afraid of tomorrow. Don't let the enemy bring fear upon you, right? You have the ability to speak to that thing, to pray over it, to plead the blood of Jesus over it. By the way, they never had another fender bender. They never had any more accidents. They always came home safe and sound. And you know, you can trust God. You can trust God with the important things in your life, the important people in your life. Do you know He loves your kids more than you do? You can trust God with your family. Amen. Amen. And so we... life, God is life, and we want to speak life and speak words of faith and not speak words of fear. And then we take our positions of authority over the enemy that wants to destroy us. And you know, we begin to understand the power to our lives really lies with what we are saying. Praise God. That doesn't mean we don't speak the truth. Sometimes you have to say a hard thing, but we speak the truth in love because it's the truth that makes us free and gives us liberty. Amen? And sometimes we have to have difficult conversations with those we love or those who are part of our lives and what you say. But what you say can bring freedom even if they don't receive it right away. Understand, there's power in your words, and so we make our words give life. Praise the Lord. 1 Peter 4:11 said, if anybody speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so as one who does with the strength that God provides. And so that in all things, God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To Him be the glory and the power forever. Amen. So we, people of faith, are you a person of faith? Raise your hand, wave at me. We're people of faith, right? And so when we speak, we're to speak like God and speak the very words over all of our circumstances and situation. Remember, God's not a liar. God tells the truth. Satan is the liar. God is the father of truth. Satan is the father of lies. So when you're going through a hard time, who are you going to believe? Are you going to believe the word of God? Are you going to believe the word of the enemy? The choice is yours. And so we have to change the way we think about trials and hardships. We have the image that when you become a Christian that everything is wonderful and you're never going to have any problems. Quite the contrary. What happens when you become a Christian, you're now walking in the truth. Everything you were in denial about before you came to the knowledge of the Lord surfaces, and you have to deal with it. You don't have more problems when you get saved. That's you're just now dealing with the problems you never dealt with. Does that make sense? And so we learn to handle our situations, our problems, our circumstance. We learn God's ways to handle adversity. So we have to stay steady. Everybody say, stay steady. We got to stay steady, allow the Holy Spirit to clean us up. You know, that's okay. I was one of those people. When I first came to the Lord, I was the one at the altar every single week. I was the one crying. I call it Holy Spirit therapy. I was the one. I needed a box of tissues. I had tears and everything, and that was me every single Sunday. And then a lot of Sundays it felt like, oh my gosh, how long is this going to take? Am I always going to cry in front of people? Am I always going to be the one at the altar? You think stuff like that, but just don't think that. Just allow the Holy Spirit to heal you and do what He needs to do, and I promise that you will get delivered. And when you get delivered, there is a place in God where you're going to sense His peace, and you're going to sense His power, and you're going to realize, I'm healed. It's good. It's a good life. Praise the Lord. You know, I don't cry much today. Well, I don't need to cry because I did a lot of crying way back when. I don't cry much today. Why? Because I've been delivered. I've been healed. I've been set free. And those things, those broken pieces in my heart have been put back together. God has restored me. And when you have been restored and you've been healed and you've been delivered, you got a lot of joy. And you know that no matter what you're going through, that God has an answer for your situation and that you're going to make it. Look at your neighbor and tell him, I'm going to make it. We're going to make it. Yeah, we're going to make it. This is our year. This is the time. And so we speak the word of God over our lives. And we let the Holy Spirit clean us up. You know, the other issue Christians have gotten into is sometimes they get into dread when dealing with trials of life. You know, and they'll say things. We'll say, well, how you doing? Well, the devil's really attacking me. The devil's really getting to me. The devil's just really coming after me. And we give so much credit to the devil, right? When we should say, you know what, I'm going through stuff, but I know that God has an answer, right? Isn't that a better way of saying it? We have to change our minds when dealing with the devil. I want to tell you something about the devil. He's defeated. He's defeated. He's done. He's over. He's finished. I've read the last chapter of Revelation. He is gone. He's going to spend his time in a lake of fire. Well, I want to tell you, I don't have time listening to somebody that's a loser and over and going to spend their time in a lake of fire. I don't need to hear what they have to say about my life. They don't get to speak into my life, right? When God has told me so very clearly in his word that greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Amen. And so that spirit that's on the inside of me is greater. That spirit on the inside of me is greater than whatever the devil may try to say to me. That spirit on the inside of me is greater than whatever the devil may try to do to me. That spirit on the inside is greater. I don't care what people say. I don't care what people do to me. What I care about is greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. And when I get a revelation of that spirit that's on the inside of me, I know that no weapon formed against me shall prosper. I know that I have authority to speak over all things that come against me. Why? Not because of who I am, but because who lives inside of me. That greater is the spirit that lives in me than he that lives in the world. And I tell you, when you get a revelation of that, you'll be 10 feet tall. You can take any problem head on. Now, I'm not telling you there's not times when you're not sad or grieved over the situation. Sure, there's times, but we don't stay in those places. We get up, we dust ourselves off, we pull up our boots, and we go forward in the name of the Lord because we are soldiers of the Lord, and he's called us to fight this good fight of faith, and we pick up our sword, and we fight another day. Amen? So we never give up. We never quit. We change what we say. We line our words up with the word of God. If we're not seeing what we want to see, and we begin to see differences in our lives. So as people of faith, we are to speak like God. Now I want to give you an example. This is one of my all-time favorite examples of speaking life in the word. And, and I've talked about it quite a bit, and it's Ezekiel chapter 37. And y'all know the story. Ezekiel, he gives us a story that the Lord took him in a vision, and he brought him out by the Spirit of the Lord to a valley, and it was desert. And in this valley, there was full of bones. And he said that the Lord led him back and forth in these valleys. So there was lots of skulls. There was lots of bones. Evidently, there'd been like a big battle there at one time, and none of them got buried, and they were all strung out on the desert floor. And the Lord said to him, Ezekiel, can these bones live? And Ezekiel said to the Lord, he said, Sovereign Lord, only you know. And then the Lord said to Ezekiel, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. And this is what the Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you and you will come to life. And so I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. And then you will know that I am the Lord. So Ezekiel, he obeyed the word of the Lord and he prophesied as God commanded him. And as he was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. And he looked, and then the tendons and the flesh appeared on the bones. And then he looked, and the skin began to cover the flesh and the tendons. But there was no breath in them. And then the Lord said to Ezekiel, he said, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come, breath, come from the four winds, and breathe into these that are slain, that they may live. And so Ezekiel obeyed, and he prophesied as the Lord told him, and he commanded the breath to enter in to those, and they came to life, and they stood up on their feet, a vast army. And then the Lord said to Ezekiel, he said, son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say our bones have dried up. They say our hope is gone. They say we're cut off. Therefore, prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. My people, I'm going to open up your graves and bring you up from them. I'm going to bring you back from the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. And when I open your graves and bring you up from them, I'll put my spirit in them and you will live. And I will set you in your own land, and then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken. I have done it, declares the Lord. Praise God. So there's just these bones. They're dead. There's no life in them. But Ezekiel, through the power of the Holy Spirit, begins to prophesy, and they come back together, and they form a vast army. God has made it that we can create like him through the power of what we say. So when situations arise in your life, you speak. When the devil tells you you aren't going to make it, you speak. When all hell breaks loose, you speak. We are to take dominion over the darkness. We use our voice for prophecy over the trials, over the tribulations, and we speak and we speak and we speak, and it seems like nothing is happening, but you speak, and then all of a sudden there's a sound. All of a sudden there's a noise of bones coming together and a rattling sound of bones coming into place, but you don't stop speaking. You speak because the flesh needs to come on the bones, and you keep prophesying to your problem. You keep prophesying to your children. You keep prophesying for your job. You keep prophesying for your family. You keep prophesying for your family and your finances, and you keep speaking, and God will breathe life into that you're speaking to. God has given you the ability to create with the power of your tongue, and you take dominion over the problems of the life of this life, and you tell the devil he's not in control. Amen. He's not. He doesn't get to tell you how your story ends. You decide how your story goes. You decide how your story ends. What do you want people to say about you after you've gone on to be with the Lord? That's your decision right here and now about what your life says to other people. I tell you what I want my life to say. I want people to say that I spoke life. I want people to say that I was a fighter. I want people to say that I took dominion over the devil. I want people to say that I didn't put up with the devil's garbage in my life. I want people to say that I'm an overcomer. What about you? Is that what you want people to say about you? Well, we have the ability through the power of what we say to change what is happening to us. So we say words that bring life. Amen. We say them. We speak it. I want y'all to repeat after me and speak these words of life over yourself. I'm valuable. I'm redeemed. I'm forgiven. I'm approved. I'm successful. I'm victorious. I'm talented. I'm healthy. I'm energetic. I'm happy. I'm positive. I'm passionate. I'm strong. I'm confident. I'm secure. I'm attractive. I'm free. I'm qualified. I'm motivated. I'm focused. I'm determined. I'm patient. I'm kind. I'm generous. I'm empowered. I'm well able. I am a child of the Most High God. That's who we are. Amen? Praise God. And so I want you to speak life. We're here to speak life, and I want to give us a moment. If you'll just stand, we're going to stand. Now, we've done this before, but sometimes we need a tune-up, you know? That's what this sermon is about. It's a reminder to all of us to watch what we say and what's in our heart and to guard our hearts and to guard our mouths, right? As we enter 2019. I just want to speak live 2019, that the end of 2019, I see what I've spoken. Isn't that amazing? That's what I want to see. What about you? I want to give you a moment to stand and to prophesy. Now think of some difficult situations in your life right now. What are those situations? And we're all going to talk at once. And I'm going to tell you, in Africa, they know how to do this quite well. When you tell them to prophesy in their life, you don't have to pull teeth to try to make them prophesy. They begin to prophesy. They know what they're believing for. They know what they want to overcome. And they begin to pray and shout it and take authority over it. Well, that's what we're going to do too. Amen? And we can take their lead, and we can just be just like the Africans and begin to prophesy to those situations in our lives that we need deliverance. God already knows what you need deliverance from. The enemy already knows what you need deliverance from. You already know what you need deliverance from. Amen? So you begin to speak to that thing, speak the word of God over that thing, and begin to see the deliverance. Now, Satan's going to hang on as tight as he wants, but you know what? He's defeated. He has to release it when you speak the word of God over your life. Amen? Amen. So whatever it is going on in your life, whatever it is, we're going to speak out loud. Why do we speak out loud? We speak out loud so the devil can hear you. That's why we speak out loud. We speak out loud so we let him know that we're taking authority over him and we're taking authority over the bondage that he's trying to put on us. Amen? That's why we speak out loud. All right, so you ready? I'm going to count to three, and then we're going to start. If you want to speak in tongues, you can do that too. All right, but make sure you prophesy and declare in English or Spanish so that the devil knows what you're saying. Amen? All right, one, two, three. Let's go. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we just declare all of those situations that have come against us, where Satan has tried to steal, where Satan has tried to destroy, where Satan has tried to kill us. We take authority over those situations right now in Jesus' name. God, I declare health and healing in our lives. I declare finances in our lives, where the dam has been stopped up, where the finances are, God. We pray release right now. We declare a release right now in the finances of Word of Life and everybody that's here today in the name of Jesus. Father, I just thank you that as tithers, we can come boldly to your throne and we can declare tithers' rights. Lord, we have tithers' rights here today. We have a right to be healed. We have a right to be whole. We have a right for reconciliation to come to our families, and we declare that right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we take authority over strife in our families. We take authority over strife in our marriages. We take authority over the things that come to try to pull us this way and that way. We take authority over those things in Jesus' name. We speak peace. We speak healing. We speak restoration to our lives in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for your word that says in Psalm 103:3 that I am whole. That you heal all of my diseases. And so I don't have any diseases because I am whole by your word in Jesus' name. Father, I thank you that your word says in Exodus 14:14, the Lord will fight your battles. You only need be still. And Father, every battle that we face today, God, we know that you are fighting that battle for us. We know that you have gone before us. We know, God, that you have a plan and you have a good plan for our lives. It's a plan of prosperity. It's a plan of healing. It's a plan of deliverance. It's a plan for nothing missing, nothing broken in the name of Jesus. And we are healed. We are whole. And we are reconciled to every person you want us to be reconciled to in the name of Jesus. We take authority over those things that try to steal, kill, and destroy and to bring grief and sorrow to our lives. We take authority over that in Jesus' mighty name. God, we thank you. Now let's praise him and thank him. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your love. We thank you, Lord, that you are our God. We thank you for your sweetness and your kindness and your gentleness towards us. We thank you that you lead us. We thank you that you guide us. We thank you that you never leave us and you never forsake us and that you're always with us. We love you, Lord, and we give you all the praise and all the honor. And everybody said, amen. 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 God is good. Well, we're going to have some altar time. I just want to encourage you to come down. If you have some things that you want to give to God, I just encourage you, make this year the closest year you've ever been to God. Make this your year between you and God, that you draw closer like you've never been before. Seek him. That's what the word says. Seek him and he'll be found. So God bless you. I'm just going to spend some time down here. I hope you join me.
Word of life, speak to my weary heart, strengthen my broken parts, lead me to your open arms.